into it. My name is Theo Lachev, and this session is going to be about scaling business intelligence. Just kind of briefly introduce myself. I'm a consultant, author, and mentor focusing on Microsoft BI. I'm running a small business intelligence company in Atlanta. I'm from Atlanta also. And I've been Microsoft SQL MVP for 5 years. I'm leading the Atlanta BI group. Anybody from Atlanta? Atlantans? Okay, we got a few you guys don't know. We're meeting every month. Our next meeting is going to be on Monday. You can check up our meetings in AtlantaBISQLPass.org. How many of you actually were on my last session that I just did? The top 10 reasons to upgrade to reporting services? Anybody was there? Okay, only one. Very good. Thank you for being a loyal follower. All right, so let's get into it. So the agenda of this session is going to be, I'm going to give you a practical load testing methodology, something that I used in my real life projects about how to test reporting services and analysis services. I'll show you how to analyze results and pinpoint performance bottlenecks. I'm going to share also some best practices at the end in terms of optimizing reporting services, a little bit about MDX optimization, as I said. That's what we're going to be talking about. Does it sound reasonable? Is that what you guys expect? Okay. Okay, why load test? The question of the day. Pretty much to avoid this. This picture is actually taken from an Indian city, but those of you who are from Atlanta or in big cities, you'll find this also very familiar. If we don't load test, you know, everything looks good in development. Once we move it to production, problems start. So production is like a wild jungle. You know, a lot of users coming. It cannot predict who is coming up. So if you don't do a load testing and if we don't know how our solution actually scale, then we may end up in, essentially we end up in a situation where it doesn't respond at all. So pretty much by load testing, we're trying to determine the server through output, how many reports per second my report server can handle, how many queries my analysis service queries per second, for instance, how many concurrent users, how the multi-user load impacts the server resources. Where's my bottleneck? Is it the CPU? Is it the memory? The disk? So I gotta know these questions so I can plan. You know, I know how far I can go. I can plan this. So if I take an example from real life, recently a customer came in and said, "Hey, we've got this." They actually, by the way, ISV vendor, and they were doing cubes, and they had a big customer. You know, so they sign up with a big customer, and the customer obviously asks them, what will it take to run this cube in-house? And because that was a very important customer, you know, this ISV vendor said, you know, go and buy a server, one of these enterprise-level servers, ProLiant 1000 or whatever version was, that would cost the customer $50,000. So at this point, the customer said, oh, can you tell me why I have to spend so much? I have only 5 users that are going to actually access that cube, and you ask me to do spend $50,000. So we looked at the analysis services configuration, we looked at the cubes, and I sided up with their customer and saying that, okay, you don't need such a big server. You know, if you buy something $10,000, $15,000, that's going to be capable of running this cube. You don't have to spend so much. So this is some of the questions actually we're trying to answer by doing load testing. All right, so here's a typical BI solution that I'm seeing over and over and I'm implementing over and over. So we've got a report server, we've got data warehouse server, we've got analysis services server. Then we have reports. We have transactional reports that are run directly against the data warehouse server, kind of a detail level reports that are not suitable to be serviced by the cube. Then we've got what I call analytical reports, trend or kind of historical reports that actually run from the cube. And also the cube is being accessed by other clients. Maybe we have Excel clients, maybe we have third-party tools. So in this presentation, I'm going to show you, I'm going to focus on the testing reporting services and analysis services. One thing that I want to make clear upfront is that you shouldn't make any assumption as far as where the bottleneck is going to be. This is very important, and I'm seeing this mistake over and over. If I have to give you another example from real life, you know, I was in a project recently, and the customer said, you know, they had a similar topology. They said, okay, we are planning to run, so right now, let's say we have 20 users. We are planning to upgrade to 500 users. Let's go and scale the reporting services. Let's go and implement a farm of report servers because we think that the bottleneck is going to be in reporting services. And when we do the load testing, we find out that actually even one report server can handle the load just fine. What was where the bottleneck was actually the data warehouse server, because some of those reports had very complex queries. And what actually the bottleneck was, as I said, in the data warehouse server. So you shouldn't make any assumption. You should test. And by testing, then you will discover where is the weakest link in this chain. How to load test? Here's the simplified three-step approach. Establish a performance goal. Obviously, we have to, when we work on something, we have to start with the end in mind. We have to establish a performance goal of some kind. I'm going to show you in a moment how we can do this. Then we prepare load tests that will simulate concurrent load. Number three, let's go and analyze, run and analyze the results from those tests. Do we meet the goal after we analyze the results? Do we meet the goal that we established? If yes, we're done. If no, then we gotta find out where's the performance bottlenecks. Let's go and do some fine tuning, and let's go to step three. And it's gonna be kind of an iterative approach until we meet the goal. If we cannot achieve the goal by optimizing queries and things like this, then we can scale up or scale out. Yes? Sure, absolutely, absolutely. You can do a step load, as we're going to show you in a moment. You can just see at what point actually there is a performance degradation, so you can see what happens in the future. Absolutely, that was that's a good comment. So how do we, let's now focus on step one. How do we establish a performance goal? What I'd like to do is to take a look. Now, there are different scenarios here. You may have the system already in production. You know, people may be using reports, maybe using the cube. And then maybe you may be planning to scale to many more users. In this case, if you have the system already deployed, you can take a look at the existing statistics, such as, for example, if you're load testing reporting services, you could take a look at the reporting service execution log to see, for example, where are the peak times, how many reports were executed. If we're load testing analysis services and the kube is in production already, we can capture analysis services trace to just give us some idea how the users are testing the kube. Now, the question is, what about if it's a new system? The system is not in production. Then, obviously, we have to use some theoretical estimates as far as how many users, what queries probably they're going to be running. So then the thing's becoming a little bit more difficult. But still, it's a good idea to kind of see, kind of think, you know, how many users are going to be running, what queries possibly they're going to be executing against the system. Then we estimate future use. For example, if right now you've got 20 users, but in future, maybe you're going to have 500 users running reports, then you got to know this. And then you will estimate, will establish your performance goal based on this increase that you're expecting. And then at the end, once you do this math, you express your, you state your performance goal as reports per second, for instance, if you're testing reporting services, or queries per second if you're testing analysis services. You can also do established number of concurrent users. I particularly don't like this. One of the most common issues that I'm running into is that, okay, so we gotta have requirements. So we're talking to users, you know, to give us some performance guidelines, and they say the number of concurrent users will be 500. When they do this, they make the mistake that concurrent users are not the same as deployed users. So most likely, they by 500, they mean deployed users, users who will be using the system. But that's not concurrent users. And the next slide actually kind of explains this in more details. So here, let's say on the y-axis, we have the number of users. And then on the x-axis, we have time. So let's say they're submitting queries or report requests in time. So how many deployed users you will think we have in this scenario? Six? One, two, three, four. I'll probably say five because you have, if you kind of have a, you know, if you kind of look at the y-axis, you know, maybe we have five requests going on. Then how many concurrent users we have in that time slot over there, you know, the one with the white lines? How many concurrent users do you think we have? It's only two, right? So in this particular moment of time, we have only two users. But now if I go here, maybe, you know, this little slot, then I'm going to have three concurrent users. So working with concurrent users, it's very difficult. I personally don't like it. Now, the load test can tell me how many concurrent users I can handle, but I personally would like to express the performance goal as reports per seconds or query per seconds. So here is an example from a real life that I had to recently where I had to actually load test reporting services and analysis services. This statistics, by the way, this example is just for reporting services. So in this case, the customer had already reports deployed to production. They were planning to move from 20 users to, or let's say 20, 30 users or whatever they had currently, to 500 users. So to establish performance goal, we looked at the existing report execution log. We were looking for peak times. We found that on November, for example, 22nd, the most reports were executed between 9 and 10 a.m. And this were 200 reports executed by 20 distinct users. And I'll show you in a moment how you can get the statistics from reporting services. So now that I have this, I can say that within this 1 hour, which was the peak hour across all the time that I had statistics for, then if I divide 200 reports by 3,600, which is number of seconds in an hour, I've got 0.05 reports per second. So this is what the system, the existing system, actually handled at its peak. Now, they were planning to go to 500 users. So that will represent 25 times increase. This is 500 divided by 20. So then 0.05, which is the current reports per second, the maximum, the peak reports per second, times 25 will give us 1.25 reports per second. Let's go and double it just in case. And we establish a performance goal of 2.5 reporting services reports per second. Now you're going to say, what do you mean by reports? You know, because reports are not born equal. You know, we have long reports, and we have slow reports, we have fast reports. And you're right. I mean, I can have a mix of reports, you know, different reports. So in this case, when I say reports per second, a report or query in this case is kind of an abstraction. So to understand this, think about how would you measure a highway capacity. So let's say go to a highway and say, based on my research, this highway has got to handle 20 vehicles per second. Now, you're not, you're kind of abstracting yourself. You're not thinking about how many motorcycles or how many cars or how many trucks actually will go. You establish an abstraction and say, I want to have 20 vehicles per second. So imagine yourself sitting on a highway with a stopwatch counting the number of vehicles. So you start with 5 vehicles. The highway has 5 lanes. They go very fast. Oh, by the way, when you establish the, in this case, the performance goal, probably you would say 20 vehicles with maybe 50, no less than 50 miles an hour. So you put 5 vehicles, they go very fast, 80 miles an hour, no problem. Then you put 10 vehicles, slow down a little bit, 50, and so forth. At some point, there's going to be a saturation. So instead of 60 miles, then maybe it's going to be 50 miles average speed, then 40 miles, and then you found the throughput of the highway expressed as vehicles per second. That's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to express this load testing as reports per second, and then we would run some tests to see if that's the case, if this is how much we can handle. So let's go ahead and see how we can actually take a look at the report server execution log to help us gather this historical usage, and then how we can use, if we load testing analysis services, how we can do the same with analysis services. So if I load test reporting services, there is something called execution log, which the report server automatically maintains for you. It's enabled by default, and I think the default period is like 60 days or something. So I'm going to go ahead and connect to to the database where the report catalog is located. And I'm going to go to the report server database, and then there is a tables, and here is the execution log storage, which keeps track of every time the user goes and runs a server report, it gets recorded into this execution log storage. But because the information, the data in this table, it's kind of difficult to analyze, Microsoft has provided views that kind of wraps this table. So let's take a look at that execution log 2 view and see actually what information we can get. So we can get the instance name. For example, if you have a farm of report servers, this is going to tell you which exactly server serviced that request. What's the report path to, do you guys see this? Is it too small? Can you see it okay? That's a little bit small, yeah? You can see that. Let's see if this thing is going to work. So the instance name, the report path to the report, it's actually in the second column. Then we've got the user who ran the report. Then moving forward, we got the parameters that are passed to that report, the time start and time end, which will give us the how long the report ran. So now getting this, giving this information, we can copy it, put it in Excel, and do some analysis to find out. I'm looking for peak times here. And for example, in my study, I was looking for maybe an hour that was the peak hour, just to find out what was the maximum load applied to the existing system. So this is for reporting services. For analysis services, how would I get that statistics? Unfortunately, for analysis services, we don't have such an automatic execution log, but we have a trace. So what we're going to do here is we will run the SQL Server Profiler, and we would create an analysis services trace pointing to your analysis services instance. Of course, there are third-party tools too, but the one that Microsoft provides is the SQL Profiler. Here, we can save it to a file, or we can save it to a SQL Server table. Let's go and save it to a file here, this trace. And by default, I'm going to switch the template from standard to blank because I don't want any default events to go into that trace. What I really want in this trace is just the query end event. So every time the user goes and actually runs a query, there's going to be a query begin and query end MDX event. I want the query end. And the reason why I want the query end is because that's also going to give me the duration of the query. So once I have this trace, I can run it. And now I can leave it there, saving results to a SQL table or a file. And then meanwhile, the users go do their querying of the cube. For instance, that was R2, so I got to connect to the R2 instance here. They can use Excel, they can use reporting services, whatever they use to actually query the kube. Just take a minute to initialize. That's a very good question. Can I use the usage-based optimization data? Because the gentleman knows that there is a usage-based optimization wizard, which we use to tune aggregations based on the... Unfortunately, the statistics captured in the usage-based optimization log does not give you the actual query. They give you what we call a vector, for example, which attributes and which dimensions were hit by that query. But it does not give you the actual query. And what you really want for your load tests is to probably also get the queries, the actual query text. So again, going here, and let's say AdventureWorks, kube, that simulates some load going to, not load, but traffic going to analysis services server. Customer account, by date, by whatever, the year. So at this point, I should see some events actually going to the SQL profiler. And the most interesting one is the thing that I actually cannot get from the optimization log is the actual queries that are being sent to the server. The start time, the end, and the other very interesting and very important column is the duration of the query, right? Because you want to know which queries are fast, which are slow. Some of them actually take, this is actually in milliseconds, so some of them are just noise to the server. You can account by this by increasing your performance goal, as I said, doubling just to account for noise and all of this metadata queries. The one that we're really interested at is the one that take maybe more than a second. In this case, everything is very fast, obviously. Right? Piece of cake, right? Gathering the existing statistics. Shouldn't be that difficult. The next step is to prepare tests. So the first thing that I'm going to talk about is how to load test reporting services. To prepare tests, we need to have some sample reports. And we need to have a good mix of reports, maybe 10 to 15 reports, slow and fast reports, something that will be a good representative set of the load that I'm going to apply to the server. Maybe based on your examination on the statistics, you will find the most popular reports that people run. But again, try to get a mix of slow and fast reports just to simulate the load in a more realistic way. We also obtain the report URLs and the parameter values. Then, if you have Visual Studio 2005 and above, you will need the full-blown edition. In 2010, that will be Ultimate or Test Edition. These editions have testing capabilities. Then you can use that. Now, that's pretty much anything you want. Then you can create, if you, in Visual Studio, you can create something called a web performance test. Just like you can load test a web application, the Visual Studio is capable of recording the traffic sent to the report server, and you can capture that, and then you can go and apply. But I don't like this because it doesn't give me control over parameters. Most likely, when you want to simulate a report load, you want to change the parameter values as well if your reports have parameters. This is why I use unit tests. And I'm going to show you in a moment what I mean by this, because they give me complete control over how to handle parameters, even if I have cascading parameters in reports, which is parameters actually depend on other parameter selection. And once we have this unit test, then the next step will be to have create new load test wizard in Visual Studio to create the actual load test. In the process of doing this, we specify the load pattern. Is it a constant constant pattern will be good, for example, to identify things like memory leaks. Maybe you run a load test for 10 minutes and see what's happening with the memory utilization and things like this. But for load testing, I like to use stepped load because, first of all, I don't have to run it for a long time. And second, you know, it automatically increases the number of virtual users. And I can very easily see, very quickly see, at what point and how many users the system is essentially starting to deteriorate. And then when we run our wizard, we can specify a test mix, which is a collection of the unit tests. You will see in a moment how this comes to play. Counter set, to monitor the server utilization, to find out where is the bottleneck. Is it the CPU, is it the memory, or the disk? We can use Windows performance counters. And finally, there is something called run settings, which is a mix of counters. For example, I can have a one collection of run settings when I test let's say, a QA server, and another one in the same test for testing my production server. Now, the tip here when you test the tip that I want to give you when you test reporting services is that by default, to avoid denial of service attacks, there is a setting in the report server configuration file that's called max active request for one user, which is set like 10 or 20 or something like this. So when you simulate a concurrent load, most likely the report server at some point is going to start rejecting requests. So the tip here is to go to the report server configuration file and change that setting to a very large value so reporting services does not kind of reject the requests. So here's what this thing looks in Visual Studio 2010, the load test. We have something called a test mix, which is, in this case, I'm testing five reports, five reporting services reports. So what I did, I defined a test mix for these five reports, and I configured it for equal distribution, which means that each report is going to be executed equal number of times. Then you can establish browser mix, for example, if you're testing other browsers except Internet Explorer. Network mix, for example, instead of line environment, you want to simulate cable modem or DSL line speed and things like this. The other important thing is the load pattern. As you can see right now, it's set for step load pattern. And if you look at the properties pane on the right, you can configure what's the initial number of virtual users, what's the maximum number of users, and then with each step, you can establish the duration. For example, each step runs for maybe 15 seconds. And then after each step, how many more concurrent users we're adding to simulate more concurrent users. Counter sets is, you know, as I said, performance counters that will help you monitor the server utilization. And the run settings are the kind of the collection of counter sets and run settings, for example, warm duration, how long this test you want to warm up the server before we start executing. And you can have different run settings for different servers you want to test. Yes, go ahead.
What about cache settings?
Very good question. So the question is about what about caching? So obviously, analysis services is takes advantage. In fact, not only analysis services, but the Windows operating system caches data a lot. This is why when you have a, I would say, relatively large cube, and then you process that cube, you will see that the first time the users go and kind of queries that cube, there is a performance degradation. And if you take a look at that profiler trace that I showed you, you will see that a lot of time is spent fetching data from disks, from the disk. But then the Windows operating system does a lot of caching. Analysis services, if you have memory, also caches a lot of stuff. Now, obviously, in your tests, you don't want to ignore this caching. This is a good thing. So that's why I would put maybe a warm-up period of 15 seconds for the queries to execute, you know, for the queries that I want to test. And then I will go and execute my tests. Now, if you want, every now and then, because the load test framework that I'm going to show you is very flexible, You know, you can write .NET code. You can say maybe after a certain number of queries, go and actually change the cache, clear the cache, just to simulate scenarios where the query results are not cached. And you can do that as well. You know, so did that answer your question? Yes. Very good question. Does reporting services have a cache? Reporting services caches things in memory, but it never caches reports or data sets in memory because these reports can be very big. Those reports, a reporting service has the concept of execution sessions. So for example, the user runs a report. This report has multiple pages. Then what the reporting services does behind the scenes, it caches the something called intermediate language format, which essentially represents the layout of the report and the data, caches that in the report catalog. The assumption here is that if the user wants to go to the next page on the report or kind of switch between pages, you don't want the report queries to be executed again. So then in this case, the paging or interactive features such as drill down, they're handled by the cache instance of the report. When you do load tests, we're not taking consideration of those features. You know, we're assuming that the users will just run reports and the results are not cached. So essentially the report is being processed from scratch. The queries are being executed, basically. In my test, I'm not simulating going from one page to another page, first of all, because that's very fast. And second, it just adds a lot of complexity in your load tests. But by default, my tests, my report server tests, do not assume, do not take advantage of reporting services caching.
But if you are, that is true if you have your reports data source as Windows authentication, as your authentication account, right? But if you use a service account, then all the sessions are still going to be through that service account,
correct? No. You're talking about data source authentication. This has nothing to do with the caching. Regardless of the authentication option that you choose for your data source, reporting services always is going to cache the reports. And they get cached. I got to show you, can show it later if we have time. But they're a special table, get cached. The default duration is 10 minutes. So the report is going to be cached for 10 minutes. If they page, then it's going to be serviced by the cache copy. After 10 minutes, automatically the session, the cache report is destroyed and removed from them. Good question. OK, so where are we? OK, I wanted to show you how we can do the load test. So I'm in, what I'm going to show you? Sorry, the load test, right? How to create load tests. OK, so I'm going to show you. I'm going to open Visual Studio 2010. And I already create a reporting services load test, but I'm going to walk you through the process just for you to see how easy it's actually to set up this in Visual Studio 2010. So as I said, I want to test 5 reports, you know, company sales, employee sales. This is some of the sample reporting service reports. And as I said, I prefer to have unit tests. So what I've did in Visual Studio, I've created a project called RS Load Simulator, which is a class library project, C#, I use C#, you can use Visual Basic, whatever your favorite language is. And then for each report that I want to test, I created a class for it. Okay? So let's take a look at this class. For example, for the company sales 2008 report. Well, this class is very simple. Basically, it has to inherit from a class called WebTest, which is a Visual Studio predefined class. Once you add the references to the Visual Studio LoadTest framework and WebTest framework, there is a special class, so we have to inherit from it. Once we inherit from it, then we specify the path of the report. Here, actually, I make the reports, my LoadTest, a little bit more flexible. I use, in the project properties, I use application settings to define where my report server URL is, Do I want to have think time to simulate think time for the user? I set it to zero. And where the reports are, this is something that I did just to make my life easier. And then I essentially use these parameters when I construct the report URL. So this report is very simple. This report does not take any parameters. The only thing that I need is just the report URL. And then this stuff here is very standard. I just return back to Visual Studio a web test requests that tell me which URL I need to hit, what additional parameters I want to pass, such as do I want to have toolbar or a command and stuff like this. And that's it. That's as easy as it can get. If the report has parameter, then the things become a little bit more interesting because you got to pass those parameters, right? So for example, if I go to, what's this report? This is the employee sales summary. If I go to employee sales summary report here, I'll see this report takes report month as a parameter, the year, and the employee. So I got to simulate this. So what I do here, I do an array of all the possible values for the months, then the years, and then the employees. And then I randomize this. So there is a function in .NET called random. I use this, I randomize it, and this is how I set my parameters for each run. Every time the Visual Studio is going to run the test, I get a new random parameter number, and I send it to the report server. But the things can get even more complicated. For example, you may have reports that actually have cascading parameters, such as the product line sales report. What do I mean by cascading parameter? Well, let's take a look at this one. Here I've got category parameter. But when I change the category, the other parameter subcategory depends on the category parameter. So essentially, there's a request back to the server to get the available values for the subcategory parameters. This presents even additional challenges, but you can handle this because, you know, this is a .NET code, so you can do whatever you want. In this case, what I decided to do for this cascading parameter is that I hard code I use a random number for the category parameter, but then once I have the category parameter, I do, if the category is one, then do a random number for 1 to 3, because if the category is 1, the subcategory IDs are going to be from 1 to 3. If it's 2, then they're going to be from 4 to 17. So this is my specific implementation. If you look at the AdventureWorks database, you will see that subcategories that match category 2 have IDs from 4 to 17. So this case is very easy. In the more complicated cases, you can go and fire a query against the database to resolve the cascading parameter values. So I've got these 5 classes for each report that I want to test. What's the next step? The next step is to right-click on the class library and say add load test. And now this is where the wizard starts. And the first thing is going to ask me, do you want to use think times or you don't want to use a think time? I say don't use think time. I don't like to use think times because, you know, the more variables I add to my tests, how would I know how long the user will think between requests and how long it's going to take them to analyze the report? That's why I would prefer to express everything as reports per seconds with no think times. Just bombard the server to the point where it started deteriorating. So I don't like to. Add additional variables to it. Then, do you want to have a constant load, to apply a constant load to the server, or a step load? For the load testing, I prefer a step load. I can specify how many virtual users I want to start with, what's going to be the step duration for each iteration, and how many additional users I want to add for each new step. So I can play with that. This is not interesting. Here on the test mix, I have to add my classes that I created for those reports. So since I have 5 reports, I will select all of them and add them here to the test. In other words, I want my load test to use all these 5 reports. I can also specify distribution. So for example, if some of those reports are executed more frequently I can change my distribution here the way I want it, or I can just say equal distribution. Network miss, do you want to do, is this report going to be executed on your LAN, or it's going to be a cable or DSL? You can do that. Then the browser mix, do you want to have Internet Explorer or maybe some other browsers, Firefox and so forth? You can also specify this. The counter sets is this is where we specify the servers that we want to test. Maybe I have a server called production SSRS01. And Visual Studio comes with predefined kind of performance counters categories. For example, if I test SQL Server database, I can select that. There isn't any predefined sets for reporting services or analysis services, but that's fine. You can take some of those defaults, and then later on you can remove the counters and maybe add analysis services specific counters or reporting service specific counters. And finally, in the run settings, you can specify the duration of the test and how much warm-up time you want to have. And once you're done, you're going to actually have something like this. This is essentially the test shown in Visual Studio. It has the test mix, the counters here, as I said, the run settings. For example, let's say I want to test my production server. So that, yes? Across the network. Sure. Yeah, so when you went through this wizard, I think at that step that I showed you the setup, you can go and actually say LAN, but as far as if you can say, let's say 20% comes from LAN and 50%, I really don't know. I never use that feature. This is a standard Visual Studio load test feature. There's nothing specific to reporting service or analysis service at this point. So whatever Visual Studio lets you do. Okay. So this is as far as creating tests, load tests. So now that we have the load tests, what's going to... Very good question. Is the demo available online? I'm going to post. For some reason, they didn't ask me this time to actually give them the source code. So I don't know what's the deal with the source code. But I would definitely post it on my website, Prologica with K.com, maybe tomorrow or so. So you're going to be able to get it from here. Definitely, I'll commit to actually upload this and the previous session source to my website, on my company website. I also blog about it. I have a blog and just show you where the location is just to make it easier for you to find it. All right, so this is where the fun. So we got the load test. We did all the hard work of how much time we have, by the way. So this is going to be 4:15. Okay, 6 o'clock, okay, half an hour. So we collected all the load tests. Now it's time to run them and just sit back and see what's going on and where the system actually started deteriorating. When I run my tests, the first thing I run them maybe one or twice to see which one becomes the performance bottleneck when I apply step load. Usually the CPU becomes the bottleneck. Before I record the official findings, I don't take the maximum true output, the reports per second, where actually this graph picks out. I would like to take them at 80% utilization of CPU or memory if the memory is bottleneck, because I want to leave some room to that server. You know, there are other things running on the server. I don't want to actually max out completely that server, so I take it at 80% utilization. Visual Studio Load Test lets you record reports per second and concurrent users to document that. Make sure that you watch for errors. So first iterations when you do the load test, make sure there are no errors. For example, bad URL requests or the queries are not formulated. Later I'll show you about analysis services, how you can troubleshoot this. A limitation of Visual Studio out of the box is that it supports 250 virtual users. If you want more users, you have to buy something called a license pack for more users. But if you don't want to do this, then the easiest workaround is to have multiple test machines where you're running your tests. So let's say I have my laptop and my colleague has a laptop running, opening the same test. And then at the same time, we say, ready, set, go, and everybody press the button, and that's how we can simulate more users. Although 250 users will be, I think, more than enough to simulate, to actually see performance degradation on assuming a single server. That should be good enough. So how do we find the performance bottlenecks? How, when we run this test, how do we know where the performance bottleneck is? Well, we'll use Windows performance counters. The typical bottlenecks are CPU. For this one, we have a performance counter called processor processor time. Memory, the memory can be maxed out, and we have performance counter for it. The hard disk may get saturated if it's a lot of disk intensive test. Network, and if none of them actually gets saturated, that could be the system bus. So if you look at the computer architecture, all these messages, the data actually get moved around something called a system bus. And then if nothing else, actually, if none of these performance counters are moving or actually show you that there is a performance degradations, most likely we're actually saturating the system bus. This is what Visual Studio will give you as far as reporting capabilities. It shows you very nice graphs. The first thing, the first graph on the left, on the top left, is the key indicators, and the red line there shows you the step load. So we started with one user, then we added another user, the third user, and so forth. The green line below it shows the page per second. Now, Visual Studio uses a universal term, page per second, although in this case, because we're testing reports, this actually represents reports per second. The graph below, it's probably the most important one, the one that's called system under test. This one shows you the performance indicators for the server or servers you are testing, because you can put performance counters for multiple servers. For example, if I test reporting services, I can put the CPU utilization of my report server, and I can put the CPU utilization also of my database server or analysis services server to kind of see everything in one graph. I think the green line on this graph shows you the memory, pretty stable. In fact, it's going down for some reason. But the CPU at this point is really having a hard time, and as you can see, in fact, by default, Visual Studio has a threshold violations. If it exceeds above 80%, then actually you're going to start seeing a threshold violation, all these warning little icons that show up there. So that should be good enough for you to understand and do your tests. There are a lot of more capabilities in Visual Studio, detail analysis, but this probably just monitoring the counters, monitoring these graphs, see at what point the system actually exceeds 80% utilization, should be good enough. So let me go ahead and show you. So we've got this test, now it's time to run it. The first thing before you run it, I'm gonna go to one of my report classes and I'm gonna make a error on purpose. I'm gonna say that the URL of this report is, let's say I made a mistake, instead of company sales 2008, is 2008-1. So now I'm gonna go to my load test that I created. Oop, sorry about this. go back to the company sales, and what I did, I changed the URL to the company sales 2008-1 to just introduce a syntax error in my URL, and then I went to my load test, and I'm going to execute it. So how do you execute it? You just expand that drop down and say run test, and when you do this, at some point, Visual Studio is going to start actually executing those report requests, you know, one by one off of whatever reports I scripted. It's going to go first through a warm-up duration, if I specified any warm-up time, and then it's going to start running those tests. Why don't I see an error here? There should be an error that shows me. It's weird. Ah, there's it, okay. So I see some errors. If there's any errors when you run your test, you should see some error messages here. So that I stop the test right here. I click on this errors, and I see that here this company sales report errors out. So if I click on it, I've got more detailed information. And if I click on the test log, it shows me even more detailed information that tells me that this URL cannot be found. So now I have my indication that something is wrong. What I'm trying to say here is that, you know, just run your test first, eliminate all errors, make sure that you have no errors before actually make some conclusions. Because if there is an error in that URL, you will see the throughput, the pages per second, going very fast. You'll see, oh, my system can scale a lot. But this is really just errors coming out from the report server because it's erroring out. So it can completely obscure your results. So now we're going to do it for real, and we'll see what happens with my system. Now, bear in mind that in my case, I'm using both my laptop as a test controller that actually goes and fires those report requests, and as a server. So you will see also the controller pane on the top, on the right bottom, also kind of maxing out. That shouldn't happen, of course, in real life because you will be testing a kind of separate server. So, okay, so we take a look at this user load. Right now we've got one user. The first iteration is over. Now it's two users. We're putting some, we're increasing the number of concurrent users. And again, we're taking a look now at the system under a test graph here. That tells us, that actually shows us, I just chose two counters. The red one is the CPU utilization, and the green one is the memory. So we're keeping an eye on it to see what happens. So now I've got five users, and I have 15 reports per second. And we keep on adding users. So now I've got six users, six concurrent users, and we're very close to 80% CPU utilization. And I'm servicing about 14 requests per second. I'm taking a look at the pages per second counter, the one that I highlighted. Okay, so exceeded 80%. I think at this point we're done. We're going to see probably a little bit of fluctuation, but we can say that maybe with six, seven concurrent users, I exceeded my goal of 80% utilization. So at this point, my server, obviously, the CPU is the bottleneck. The memory was okay, but the CPU is the thing that is maxing out. So I'm going to stop my test. I can see more detailed results, for example, how each report was executing. What's the average time for executing each report? See which one are the slowest reports and the fastest reports. But I usually, except when I go to performance tuning to take a look at the individual reports, I really don't pay attention to this detailed information. The graphs are good enough information for me because it's just help me visualize what's going on very easily. So that's it. That's about load testing. That's how you can load test reporting services. Any questions before we move on to analysis services? Okay. So I showed you reporting services. And let's now talk about analysis services. How do we load test? How many of you are using analysis services? OLAP cubes. Ooh, all of you. Very good. I don't know. Maybe 80%. Good. Good. Good for you. That's what you should be doing. I love analysis services. So how do we test analysis services? In my projects, I use a framework which was put together by, I think, Microsoft and Hitachi Consulting. It's available for downloading from calplex.com. At the end of this presentation, I have a link to it. This framework consists of two projects, something called Query Generator and a Load Simulator. The Query Generator is a Visual Studio project that lets you create template queries. So you've got your MDX queries, for example. You want to parameterize them by specifying the range of available values. This is something that the query generator can do for you. Once the queries are generated, the templates are generated, then the load simulator can actually use those queries to send them to the analysis services server to simulate load, just like we did that with the reporting services. The framework comes also with the Word document for analysis services load testing best practices. I would suggest you read it. It has very important information. Recently, so this, the analysis services framework requires Visual Studio 2008 or above. If you do not use Visual Studio, then another option recently that actually got introduced is that somebody wrote a another analysis services framework which does not require Visual Studio. I personally haven't used it. I always use the query generator because it's been there for a long time. But you can take a look at that one and see if it's, as I said, has been very recently added to Codeplex and see if it will help you. All right, so let's go and take a look at how we can test analysis services. So I have the analysis services projects as a part of my one solution that has the reporting services testing and analysis services. As I said, the analysis services framework has two projects in it, the load simulator and the query generator. The query generator is where this is the tool that I would use to generate queries. There is a file, special file called query template. This is where I put my MDX queries, the one that I want to use for a load testing. So I capture those MDX queries. I put them in here. So in this case, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 queries for that test. You should have, in real life, you should have more queries. The interesting thing what this query generator does is that also it lets you parameterize those queries. So as you can see, for example, this query here obviously takes parameter the particular month as a parameter. This is maybe an Excel query that I use for this load test. Instead of hard coding the parameter values, I specify a placeholder called time underscore month. And then at the end of this file, I specify what this token will represent. So the time underscore month token, I would say I'm going to use a set, a MDX set, that the query generator is going to go and execute against the server to find the values, the valid values that can be passed to this parameter. So in this case, I'm saying, hey, give me all months that have internet sales amount. So what's going to happen once I specify this, also I have to specify how many, what is the maximum number of these tuples, these tokens that actually can be used in this query. In this case, I specified that the maximum quantity is 1 because this query, I want to execute it for a single month. But if I take a look at another query, like for instance this one here, also an Excel query, obviously does some kind of analysis for years on columns, then for this one, I have another token. And if I go down, I will see that this token is also defines a set that gives me all years that are not empty, which actually they have sales amount. And for that one, I say that the minimum quantity is 3, the maximum is 4, meaning that at minimum, I should have 3 years in this query, and at maximum, I should have maybe 4 years in that query. So what's going to happen when I run this query generator is he's going to look at these queries, is going to go and get these tokens, is going to execute these sets, and is going to create permutations. And how many permutations is going to create depends on how many users I want to, the maximum number of virtual users that I'm planning to run my test for. So in this case, it's 50 users. I specify 50. And I say that the queries are going to be saved in this particular folder. And that's going to be the naming template of those files, q.xml. So now if I go and press Control F5 to actually run this query generator, which is implemented as a console application, it's going to go, it's going to query the server. for all these tokens, and it's going to generate a. Can I do this? Yep. It's going to generate a some statistics at the end. It's going to tell me that I generate 5 query sets, and this is the token that these queries actually take. What is the uniqueness? For example, how many unique queries I have for each of these token? Obviously, you try to get more value, so you have more uniqueness. In other words, simulate more distinct queries. Let's give me some statistics at the end. The actual queries get saved into this folder that I specify. And that folder is, I decided to put it in here. So if I go to this folder, I see the query files that the load framework is going to use when I go through the load test. So I see actually the actual MDX queries replaced with the parameter values, with the actual parameter values. So at this point, what you have to do is to test these queries before you run the load test. Go and copy them. Go to the your cube and execute those queries to make sure they're valid MDX queries, because the query generator doesn't care about grammar. It just substitutes. It's just dummy substitution of these parameters. It cares about the parameter sets because it executes them against the server to get the values, but not about the actual query. It doesn't execute the actual queries. So for you, you have to go and manual work here. You have to go and actually test those queries in Management Studio, replace those XML ampersand with the real ampersand, make sure the query is valid. And if it's valid, then if all the queries are syntactically correct, then we're ready to go to the next step. And the next step is to, just like in the reporting services, I had a load test. I have the same thing for analysis services. The only difference is that when I went through the wizard to create my load test, in the test mix, I did not add reports, but I added this special class, which comes with that framework called loadstart. That's the test name. So that's why I added. From that point on, I can just add the counters, and just like what I did for reporting services. So once we did this, we can go ahead and run that test. And the output is going to be similar. It's just that in this case, I'm firing queries to test analysis services instead of sending reports to the reporting services server. I'll see a warm-up. I'll see the step load, because that's what I requested, starting with one user, then maybe 5 users, 10 users, whatever your step variance is. And at some point, the server, my laptop, is going to max out. We are watching the red line in the system under test graph. And also, we are looking at also the key indicators, which shows us the number of concurrent users that are being run. So as you can see, the red line is going up. It looks like CPU again. It's going to be the performance bottleneck until it reaches maybe 80%. And then we say, hey, here's the how many concurrent users this server can handle. And this is how many queries per second it can handle. Now, as far as query per second here, you have to be by test by second. Here, what we mean is not the queries per second. This is the batches of queries that are being executed against the server. You can remember that each one of those has 5 queries in it. So essentially, this tells us how many batches of queries are executed. So I have to multiply this by 5 if I want to convert this to queries per second. So that's it. That's how you test analysis services if you want to just focus on analysis services testing. The results, Visual Studio saves results into a SQL Server database that you specify. You can always go back and say, where was that? Open and manage results to see results, open them, and kind of do what-if analysis, compare them between runs. pressed for time, so I'm going to run a little bit. So let's now move to performance best practices. So let's say you run the load test, you discover that the system does not meet your performance goal. What do you do? You got to take a look at different options to optimize the load. I would suggest you plan early for load testing in your implementation cycle. One mistake that many implementers do, they test, they create their reports in developer environment where they have a small data set. And then production, when they move to production, oh my God, everything, you know, breaks down and the things are slow and things like this. So I would like, when I have my projects, to have a representative data set for production and periodically test against the production server to make sure that the system actually is scalable and meet my performance goal. Always tune and optimize before scaling up or out. A lot of work, Microsoft did a lot of work in the area of reporting services and analysis services to make them scalable, especially in the 2008 release. So by tuning out and optimizing, you can achieve a lot. In reporting services, I would say if you are running into performance bottleneck, your first stop is going to be the execution log that I showed you. For analysis services, take a look at the profiler to get the time spent in the storage engine and the formula engine. And there is a, Microsoft has a performance guide. Definitely suggest you read it. I have a blog about, if you really want to get into it, I would consider myself as a performance buff. I really want to see exactly what's happening with a single query. If you use Visual Studio, if you use Windows 2008 or Windows 7, or and above, there is a performance framework in Windows called X Performance that gives you a very detailed breakdown about how much time is spent in disk, in CPU, and things like this. So if you want to really get into details, take a look at this blog that I've written about how to use XPerf. To give you more, best practices, upgrade to reporting services 2008. As I said, the engine has been redesigned. The reports are not that memory bound anymore. And just by moving to 2008, you'll be able to handle 3 to 4 times the number of users than previous versions. For analysis services, definitely move to analysis service 2008 or R2, because in this version, Microsoft introduced something called block computation mode, and the queries execute between 20 and 60% faster. Based on my experience, the nastier the query is, the faster it executes, the faster the gap is between 2005 and 2008. I want to show you, I want to wrap this presentation by just showing you how you can identify performance bottlenecks in reporting services and analysis services. For performance services, what I'm going to do, I'm going to go to the report server and I'm going to simulate a long-running report. And then I'm going to take a look at the, so here I have a long-running report. And then I'm going to take a look at the report again, the execution log, to see if I can get additional information about why the report is so slow. And the first step, as I said, should be for performance issues with reporting services should be the execution log, because it has these three columns here which will give you this information. These three columns are time data retrieval, time processing, and time rendering. These columns actually show the time in milliseconds. For example, the time data retrieval shows you how long the report server took in milliseconds to process all the data sets on that report. In other words, how long it took to connect to the database, execute the queries, and get the result back. Time processing, how much time is spent in processing the report, combining the layout and the data, and time rendering, how much time was spent exporting the report into the desired report format. Starting with 2008, there is additional section here, additional info, that also tells you how much memory was consumed by this report. So the report already ran in this case, so I'm going to go and re-query this execution log order by time start descending. So here's my report that I just executed. If I go to these columns, I can immediately see that most of the time, about 60 seconds was spent into getting data for this report. So for this point, I can have to take a look at my data sets, see why they're running so much, and see if there is a way to optimize it. For analysis services, let me show you an example of how you can actually, and tuning MDX is a big topic. I obviously don't have time for it, but show you a tip or two, let's go and open one MDX query here. So when I test individual queries in analysis services, one thing that I want to do is to clear the cache, because I don't want the results of my query to be cached, since analysis services, I said, and the operating system does a lot of caching. So I would like to clear the cache. And there is a special batch command called clear cache. And then I would like to, which one I'm doing here? Just give me a second. So I'm connected to analysis services. Venture works. Okay. So we clear the cache, and now let's say I determine that I have a slow query, analysis services query, that takes a very long time to execute. I go and run that query, but before I run this query, I want to do some performance work here. I'm going to open the performance profiler that comes with Windows, and I want to see if this query actually runs in cell-by-cell calculation mode or it runs in optimized block computation mode. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to add a counter. And this counter, the one that is going to tell me this information, is found in the MS OLAP R2 MDX right there. The counter is called total cells calculated. I want to see how many total cells the analysis services server has calculated for this query. So I'm going to add it, and let's go and change the graph to blue just to see what's going on here. And right now the counter actually shows me about 40 million. So I got, 40,000, I think. 40,000, it's what the current value is. So now I'm going to go and say, okay, let's go and execute this query. By the way, this query, what it does, it calculates the average across dates for 2003, and for all products that actually have sales for individual date, I'm going to average those sales for that product, but I only want to consider products who have upsell. In other words, whose current sale for that particular date is more than the last month. So if I'm going to go and execute this query, with my laptop, it takes about 3 to 4 seconds. If I take a look at this counter, I'll see that from 40,000, which was the initial value for the total sale calculated, it went to 335,000. So it's about 300 cells calculated by this query. That's a sure indication that this query actually executes in cell-by-cell calculation mode. And the culprit, if I know a little bit more about MDX, is this filter function. Because the filter function actually is not optimized, and there is nothing wrong with the query, actually. The query syntactically is okay, gives the wrong results, but it's just this filter function is what's actually slowing this query. So how do we rewrite this query to make it faster? I want to take advantage of block computation mode, which is superior calculation mode in analysis services. So what I do, instead of actually using the filter function, I'm going to add a calculated member. This member, this definition here, and I'm going to say if the sales amount, the computation is going to be the same. If the sales amount is different, is more than the sales amount from the parallel period, then I'm going to actually consider that sales amount. If it's not, I'm going to return null. And this particular trick speeds up the things quite a bit. I still do the average, but now the average is calculated across that new calculate member. And when I do this average and execute the query, now it executes in milliseconds. Even, I actually tested this query. AdventureWorks obviously is a very small cube. Everything executes very fast. I executed this with a Contoso cube, which is much larger, and the performance is dramatic, and still the query executes within milliseconds. If I take a look at this performance counter, I will see that now I moved only about 5 or 6 cells. So only 5 or 6 cells got calculated by this query. That's an indication that actually we're using the block computation mode. So it's much, much faster. And just to wrap up this presentation, by the way, guys, you can find me. We're kind of exceeding time. You can find me. I'm going to move immediately from this session down to the business intelligence area. If you have any questions, you could find me there. When nothing else helps, obviously, we can scale out reporting services and analysis services. Reporting services, we can scale out by having a farm of report servers. Analysis services, we can load balance them. There are different techniques to do that. The SQL CAT Microsoft team has a wonderful white papers about how to scale out analysis services with SAN, storage area network, without SAN. There are resources. I don't have time to go through all of them. There are selected case studies that I got from Microsoft just to demonstrate some of reporting service and analysis services scalability. You can read this by yourself. I have another session on Thursday, tips and tricks, reporting services, interactive session. You can come and join me. And as I said, I'm going to go down after this session to the business intelligence training learning center. Do we have any questions? Sorry for exceeding my quota. Thank you so much.